Welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. This week we shall be focusing on Kashmir, taking a look at a generation that has come up post-militancy, a generation that has come up in the Burhanwari era, a generation that has seen the riots of the rage and the riots of 2016, and also a generation that still seems very, very angry. We're going to try and capture and try and figure out the mood of a generation in Kashmir. Joining me for this discussion on the roundtable is Jayadev Ranade. He's a former additional secretary in the cabinet secretariat. I have Khalid Shah. He is an assistant fellow at the ORF. We have Lieutenant General Gulmeet Singh, who has served as a corps commander in Srinagar. And David Devadas, who's actually written a very interesting book that we shall be also focusing our discussion on, A Generation of Rage in Kashmir. So David, why don't I hand the book to you first, and you can tell us what is it that you've written about. Why do you think there is a generation that is still so very angry, despite all the best efforts trying to cool them down?
The thing that I realized while writing this book, Priya, was that we are talking actually of more than a generation. We are talking about the majority of the population of the valley now, who have been born and grown up in a time of violence over the last 30 years or so. It's actually two generations at least. And I've noted in this book distinct differences between the generation that was typically born around 1990 and the generation that was born typically around the turn of the century. It is that second lot, the millennials as I've called them, who were on the streets mainly in 2016 after Burhanwani was killed. And they were typically 14, 15, 16 year old. Mm. So they were very young when the uprising of 2008 happened, or even 2010 happened. So we're talking about another generation. And I have also noted that there's gradually been a rise of a new militancy. And I have talked in this book about it being different from the militancy that began in 1998 and more or less ended in 2006. And the new militancy comprising quite often of young Kashmiris of another generation started out about 2009, 2010 in a small way. Burhanwani went underground in 2010. And over the last 2 or 3 years, the convergence between stone pelting and militancy, and stone pelting during operations by the army and the other security forces, has increased. And the number of militants in the field has increased. Both young Kashmiris who have been going underground in South Kashmir, that continues to increase. And the number of infiltrators that have come from Pakistan over the last 4 or 5 years has also been increasing, but they seem to be largely lurking in North Kashmir, but there are many who are also active in South Kashmir. I have no doubt that there must be some in the city of Srinagar also in the center. Already there was an encounter in Batmalu, which has been very, very prominent in the militancy of the 1990s also. There were a couple of encounters very recently over there. So the situation is getting grim. This generation has taken the forefront. I have made it the point in this book in an entire chapter that the leadership, whether we call them mainstream or call them separatist or call them this party or this faction or that faction, the young people by and large have given up on them, do not have much faith in them. And so it's the young who in a leaderless way, which is quite dangerous for any society to have an amorphous mass of teenagers out there connected through the phone, through telephony and the internet. And on the internet, they get very, very radical messages from all over.
And there is no counter narrative that is being sold. Ranadeep, you are quite familiar with this kind of...
obviously one can't compete with him. You know, he must have done a lot of research in writing the book. But I have a couple of points as well as a couple of questions. Firstly, my impression from discussions there and from visits there is not that the majority are extremist or are pro-militancy. In fact, the majority are not. There are a small, very active, possibly volatile lot who are militants. And as far as the youth are concerned, I would go with you that a large number are sort of becoming militant, but I would attribute that to possibly two reasons. One, the youngsters who are 14, 15, maybe even younger, who are involved in stone pelting, who have been involved in stone pelting, Could they be classified as opportunists? That is what I would ask you, because there is incontrovertible evidence that a lot of them were actually given payments on a daily basis. It was like a daily wager. They were getting cash for what they did, and many of them did not really care one way or the other. The second, and I think that's a more ominous development, is what you spoke about, the radicalization. You made a passing reference. My information is that a number of the mullahs or the head priests of the mosques that are in existence in southern Kashmir are actually now radicalized mullahs who are there. They have displaced the ones who were there earlier and they have come in. So when we talk of the youth losing faith in the older lot of leaders, which basically means the Hurriyat and the separatists, and here I must add that everyone I spoke to has basically said what you said, that the Hurriyat is virtually, they have very little following, in which case, of course, that begs the question why they're still tolerated. But it is these people, these radicalized or shall I say fundamentalized heads of these mosques who are actually radicalizing the youth. And I think that's an ominous development, because the political parties in Kashmir seem to be running with the hare and hunting with the hound. I mean, depending on yes. where their votes are. Mm. So I'm just putting these points out there, and I'm sure we'll get another chance from Pierre to further develop the conversation.
I'll let everybody make
let
a point.
There are several questions that have come up, and I'm going to lose track.
Let everybody come, then we'll come back to you. Yeah.
Talking of radicalization, most definitely there is radicalization, and over the years there's been a drastic shift from a certain kind of Islam that we used to follow, the Sufi Islam, to now a more Wahhabi or Salafi Islam. That's one factor of it. But there is, on the other hand, some sort of a political radicalization as well. The numbers, if you look at it, are not so grave in terms of active combatants, the people with the gun. But the problem is the connect with the people. Every time when the security forces go in, you have 10,000 people coming in from different villages, traveling tens and dozens of kilometers to actually go to the encounter site to rescue these people. So that people connect is the biggest challenge to the security right now. And why that people connect is there needs to be asked. Because if we've seen previously, the Kashmiris were by and large done with the gun, they were done with the violence, and everyone was moving towards a sense of a life with peace and dignity. But why we have come to that point is very important, because what is happening now may not be the problem of active combat or kinetics for that matter, is the people connect, which is getting amplified by social media. And talking of social media also, in a sense, has become a weapon. Today, we have come to a point where a small video of a cop being arrested is more potent than 15 or 20 or 30 AK-47s where a group goes in and attacks. And you have to also correlate it with the number of attacks that are made on security forces. That's very low. Very low, attacks which are damaging. So the aspect there is the people connect, and something that went wrong over the years is what's leading these people to come in support of these militants. And that's by far the most problematic aspect, and that's something that needs to be dealt with.
Let me get left in Gurmeet Singh, and you, sir, you've been in Srinagar, Kashmir. The connect, is it not there for the security forces also?
I find this book very good because after all, the basic victim of the terrorism period has been the population.
Correct.
That innocent civilian whom we call Awam. My heart goes out to them, actually, because they haven't had the environment which they actually needed. They needed the environment of peace, education, and development. But somewhere, and very interestingly, this the time cap that this book is dealing, 2007 to 2017, is exactly the time I have been in the valley. Okay. I went as a brigadier in 2005, and I came back as a corps commander, having risen in that exactly in the same period. So I have seen this period very closely and related to the people out here. I feel very pained that people have suffered. There is no doubt about this, but nobody told this story. In fact, here is the effort by the author that he's telling the story of those people. But this telling of the story is only from the one side. There is a side of security forces, there's a side of government.
Why didn't you tell his story?
absolutely. And there's a story of a villain. There's a story of a Pakistan. There is the aspiration of proxy war. There's a story of the religious viewpoint on the whole ballgame. So when I look at the 360 degrees of this problem of Kashmir, and within that I put the center of gravity as a youth, my heart goes out to them. And this book has been actually a good effort in telling what they felt.
You know, different kind of views have come regarding, say, the security forces, what the youth are actually feeling. Which one of the two do you agree with?
Let me just try and deal with some of the points that have been raised. The point about the army is quite right. I have actually got data in here, which shows that at least before 2014, until then, in that period, by and large, the majority of young people, by a small majority, actually thought good things about the army. But that was partly because the army was not so much involved with kinetic operations for a phase. I don't know if it may have changed from 2016 onwards. The point you made about the government is also very important. My point and that I've made in this book is that there's a tendency towards inertia in government and towards making sure that one's particular 2 years or 3 years in office passes off without incident. And there is no larger vision of what we're heading towards, long-term goals, etc. Now, the problem has been with the deployment of forces and the counterinsurgency apparatus. Around a decade ago, my point is that it should have been wound down as the militancy also wound down, but it didn't happen. And the young people, a new generation had come up that was fearless, that was immune to fear, having grown up in a time when they had, as little infants, seen body parts and seen grenade blasts around them, they were immune to fear. And the government just did not take account of this. Now, two or three points that were raised at the outset. One, that there is certainly a lot of radicalization. Again, I have made the point that the forces, including the army, about a decade ago, seemed to be very kindly disposed towards certain movements, reform movements, that have also now, thinking that they're only talking about the afterlife, about Jannat, etc., they're not actually bothered about politics, so these are all right. But it has not proved to be correct. Those very groups were very similar to the kinds of groups from which the Taliban emerged in Pakistan. And therefore, we haven't learned any lessons. And that kind of radicalization has also been
What about the cash for manifest. The radicalization for cash?
As far as the cash is concerned, my take is that money was distributed and sometimes there were agents, provocateur, who would start a stone pelting, you know, with a few people starting that and then melting away once a crowd had gathered. So by the time the people who actually get killed tend to be people who have not been, who have just been excited. Now, emotions are very excitable, and we need to take into account that people who get killed are not going to do it for 500 rupees. You know, it's the people who start that whole thing going. And there are wheels within wheels about that, which have been dealt with in this book. Please read it. It's a very complex story. The kinds of vested interests there are in the continuation of conflict on various sides. There are people who are talking of Azadi. There are people who are talking about the other side. There are various kinds of forces that have developed a vested interest. And I think this applies to other conflict areas also, Iraq, Afghanistan, etc., where conflict becomes self-perpetuating because of the vested interests involved.
We're going to take a break, but after the break, I'm going to come back and also take a look at the current situation in the valley, where political party after political party has said that we are going to boycott the next elections. There's a new governor in place. How much is that going to help the situation? So stay with us. Hello and welcome back to NewsX Sunday Garden Roundtable. We are taking a look at the situation in the valley. Sranade, you know, we said that the BJP-PDP government would bring some sort of peace. Obviously, that has not happened. There's a new governor in place. Yet every political party that I know, both the regional parties at least, have said they're going to boycott the panchayati elections. What is the way forward?
Well, I think, I mean, why are they wanting to boycott the panchayati elections? And when were the panchayati elections really held in Kashmir, honestly?
It's not such a strong statement.
Yeah. So I think these political parties must participate in the process. They must give the people a chance. Because it is a grassroots kind of election which is going to take place. Without that, I don't think the people are going to have an opportunity. Secondly, I think the dichotomy between the center and the state political parties has to be looked at. The position in the state, who are the strong parties and what role are they playing? Why are they not participating in this process? And that is exactly the gripe of the common people when I go and I meet them. They say that the political parties haven't really connected with them. This is the point that I think he also made,
yes,
that there is no connect. Mm. Well, this is one of the essentials of connect, and you can't have, because you're against one particular political party, you're going to sacrifice the interests of the state. Mm. And I think that's how I would look at it. Second point I'd like to make, just on going to what he said about the cash. I think cash played and plays a very important role there. There's a lot of money that is filtering across the border. There's a lot of money being paid, and I think TV channels, including yours, have shown it, to separatist elements by both sides. So I think, cash does play. So that 500 rupees, you're quite right, that the man who actually gives it melts away before the firing starts. But that happens in every crowd, whether it's in Kashmir or whether it's in Tamil Nadu. He instigates the crowd, he pays the money, and then he goes away. That's what's happening there.
And I would say more than two sides.
Okay, so, but I mean, this is part of it. And the social media has become extremely, it's a potent weapon.
Hmm.
And it is certainly being used to great effect, not only there, elsewhere also. A lot of things we are aware of, fake news, there's that, a lot of things. But the question is, how do we tackle it? And that, I think, it is the political parties who are strong in the state, who have a grassroots kind of organization, they're the ones on whom the responsibility really rests.
Which is, before you say what you have to say, also, we're talking about the youth. We have two young leaders, both Mehbooba and Omar are now at the helm. But does either of them work as an icon of hope or someone that the youth can look at?
Well, when Omar Abdullah came to power initially, he did have that sense of people connect. But when he went into the crowds among the people, people didn't feel that he was Kashmiri enough, because he himself wanted to be an anglicized version of a Kashmiri and didn't really want to be connected with the grassroots politician. But on the other hand, Mehbooba Mufti, who had the grassroots connect, lost it by joining hands with the BJP. Whatever she stood for in her political career or through the election campaign, she did the totally opposite of it. And when they came to power and said that this is an alliance between North Pole and South Pole, very well, we took it, some people agreed with it, but then the failure of that alliance also falls on the leader of that alliance. And in this case, leaders of both parties who made this alliance fail. Mm-hmm. Because a part of what's wrong there is also this alliance. There's been a lot of anger, there's been a lot of resentment, and a lot of anti-India sentiment has also come about how this alliance worked and the larger politics in the country, which is again linked to the alliance.
Correct.
So that's one another aspect that the mainstream politics, the electoral politics, has now become delegitimized to a point where it's very difficult for a political party to say we want to contest elections. I am saying that in the panchayat polls, they have their vested interests. Mm. They don't want another layer of local governance to come in. They want the institution of MLA to be the only power broker.
Okay.
They know that if a panchayat or a municipal councillor is elected by the people, he will have money to deliver governance to the people. He will be more accountable to the people because he will be coming from that mohalla, that small area, and he will have more people connect. That's one aspect. The second aspect is that they're not confident. They are not getting candidates. They don't know how many of their candidates are going to get killed or slaughtered in the process.
And that Bipol Nanantlang is still not being held.
That's partly a problem created by PDP by backing out, and also a reminder to them that what's coming
so
up
So then
next.
Does Omar look good in, maybe in comparison or because of the best man standing? Has he looked better in opposition than he did as chief minister?
Well, he did, but there is always a reminder. If we look at social media as the best, chatter that's on social media, people do remind him of what happened in his term in 2010, in 2013, for
but
that matter.
But do you think he's matured enough, or you think not so?
Well, that's for the people to judge. It's, I think from my understanding, it's going to be a tussle between the father and the son, because from my understanding, the father happens to be more popular even with his eccentricities.
Yeah, before I come to you, this question about Omar and Mehbooba, did you, when your conversations with the youth over there, did they identify with either of them, or they feel that they're leaderless, as you say?
My sense was that there was very little distinction in people's minds, in young people's minds, in schools and colleges, right across the valley where we went and asked people, between mainstream and secessionists. This is, to a large extent, an artificial divide. We found that Mr. Gilani had the largest following, but remarkably, the second largest, most popular person was Umar Abdullah, who was at that time the chief minister.
Okay.
And the third and fourth were Mufti Saeed and Mehbooba Mufti. And my sense is that both have lost ground in the last 2 or 3 years, and that it's been a continuous process from around the 2008 elections. You see, the 2002 elections was a landmark in another sense. People really began to believe in the electoral process and in the democratic process, that a change can come about. And so free and fair elections being held at that time was a great input. 2008, it led to people thinking that there's great hope now, maybe there will be another good time ahead. But Umar Abdullah was not able to fulfill those aspirations. And again, after 2014...
But you observed him in opposition. I know that's a bit beyond the ambit of your book, but you've seen him in opposition. How do you see him?
I believe that, as Khalid pointed out, that in fact, Dr. Farooq has more the pulse of the people and is able to connect better, and has a tremendous ability to reach out and connect. It's a gift which he puts to good effect. But as Mr. Rana Day said, there is a lot of double speak among various parties.
Mm.
And certainly with the positions that even Dr. Farooq has taken, some of them have been absolutely baffling, given his earlier stance.
Correct. He's known for a couple of his U-turns.
In fact, when I look at this basic question which is being discussed, I find that most important aspect is looking for solution. In fact, so many points have come out of the book. We should have learned this lesson in this period of 2007 to 2017. But what about the solution? In fact, the basic need of everybody, especially Awam, is they need governance, they need administration, they need employment, they need education, they need the very environment where the social life can go on.
Hmm.
In fact, I'm also pained on one aspect of it, that who is going to take care of the social reforms? The environment in which the families have stayed, the two generations have stayed, who is going to correct it?
Hmm.
In fact, why does a person goes for the protest and all? Who's going to correct him and all? Is it the excitement? Because they've got no engagement, there's no employment. There is, like he's brought out
what
in the book.
What he said, it's all over the ground.
Like he's given in the book. What do they do in the idle time? There's nothing to do. Basic yeah. thing which I would like to say, that Indian Army or the security forces feel that we have made tremendous sacrifice to bring the security situation to the level that where it is today.
Okay.
What has the government done for that? In fact, this a point. I would like to make an important point that this opportunity of 2007 to 2017. Has it been exploited by the government, by the society, by the system to improve the things and all? That's the question we got to. We can't be making the same mistake again.
That's it. That's what I want to ask you. Are we repeating the same mistakes over and over again, or has the narrative gone somewhat forward? Where would you say that we've done right in Kashmir? Forget wrong, we all know.
Well, I think the key is what is going to come up now.
Hmm.
The elections that you're talking about, the panchayat elections, I think they're the key. What the general spoke about, what Omar spoke about, the cash being utilized for the benefit of the common person at the grassroots level. That is what the political parties don't want to give up, and that is what is really the need of the day. It is the local politician at the mohalla level or the ward level who needs the cash. Secondly, he's the man who's going to build the social fabric, which is what the general was talking about. He's the one who's going to try and build, the social customs and whatever has gone awry. So I think that's important. But I would like to add one more thing here. When we talk of Kashmir, when we talk of all this, and as the general said, what is the future? What is the solution? I think we have to look at India in the larger context also, that we can't narrow everything down just to Kashmir. We have to look at it in the context of a solution in the larger fabric of the India as a republic. How are we going to deal with that? Why should the rest of the country get sacrificed for that? What should be the solution on that kind of a level?
So solution is not to be seen in a silo, but in a way that makes Kashmir, Srinagar also coexist with the rest of India. Integrates is actually the word that we're looking for over here. But that's it for this week. Thank you for watching this show. We'll see you again same time next week.